technician on duty. Yes, we are much grateful to have you with us this evening. Miriam, I feel it's a pleasure.
Sure.
Any time that we come, the patience and the motivation, the enthusiasm is something that we cannot take for granted. And so we really want to appreciate him for what he has been doing behind the scenes. The students will see us with a co-technician.
With his team.
Yeah. Yes, abled technicians. You know, the students only see us.
Yes.
And so they may feel, yes, we are those presenting. But behind the scenes, there are technicians presenting that we need to sometimes acknowledge and then appreciate for the work done. Because without them, there have been days we walk here and they say, the light is off.
Yes.
And you have to virtually drive back and all that. So, on the more serious note, we want to thank everyone for the opportunity. We want to thank everybody for the privilege given to us to come to you this evening with this evening's segment of the radio lecture on EDCR 232, Principles and Practice of Teaching. This evening, myself and my colleague, Miss Miriam Oga, we are here to talk about play-based learning, and specifically we're going to talk about the characteristics of playful experience. And so I'll do a little and then she would have to take over and then we continue. This is still Radio Windy Bay 98.3. You can follow us on YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, and then Instagram, even on WhatsApp. When it is time for questions, comments, contributions and all that, the studio lines that you can call is 0503 923 158 0503 923 158 0332 320 0302 5 sorry 01 0332 320 01 the number 0503 923 158 it's our SMS line and it doubles as our WhatsApp line. And so when it is time for comments, contributions and questions, you can equally call and then bring your contributions on board. Sure. And so Miss Miriam, you are welcome.
Thank you.
This evening we're here to talk about the characteristics of playful experience. But I believe that we cannot talk about playful experience when our students do not even know what, because some of us went to creche, kindergarten in remote areas. You go there, you play the whole day, and when it is 12 o'clock, a bell is rung, go home, we have closed. And so we want to talk about play-based learning. What should our students know?
Okay, thank you very much, my dear colleague. Yeah, so this evening or tonight's lecture is going to be about play. So basically we are here to play. Yeah, that is what the whole concept is about. But if you look at this, you realize that the era that we find ourselves now, 21st century, it has been recommended, I think in research, that we engage our learners in playful activities whilst they learn. And so the point is that we're looking at a situation, or we're focusing on a situation where learners find themselves in the learning environment and they don't feel like they are learning. They feel like they are playing, or we should make them feel like they are just playing but not necessarily learning. And so gone were the days when some kids will cry and their parents would have to force them to go to school for one reason or the other. Now, the issue is that when children find themselves in the learning environment, we shouldn't make them feel that they are learning. They would rather would want to learn more when they are just playing. And so, for example, in those days where during you were trying to cite an example, and so we'll be there reciting 212, 224, 236. Nothing is taking place, like rote learning. And so if they ask you to begin from 24, there will be a problem. You have to go back and start from 212 before you'll be able to. It's just like if we ask children to recite the national anthem or something. If you pick a line from the middle and ask them to continue, there will be a problem. They would always want to start from the beginning. And so that's what the whole concept is about. Children are in the learning environment. They don't feel like they are learning. They only feel they are playing. And so when we're being taught, especially at the early grades, how to write identification of numbers or writing the alphabets and the rest, and so that this teacher or your teacher would ask you to come to school with the slate. If you remember those days, a slate which has on one side the numbers and alphabets and everything, and then as the teacher writes, you write. Or usually you stand in front of the whiteboard. There was no whiteboard then. I think it was a blackboard.
Black, no white.
Yes, and so the teacher has the chalk and then you just trace. And so children were usually at that time, they didn't want to. They only become happy when they make a mistake and they have to use their uniform to wipe it. And so you go home and your uniform is so white. Your parents think that you went to school, you only went to play and came home. Away from that, now children learning has gradually changed. And so you visit most of these schools, and even when we are teaching them how to write numbers or alphabets, how do we do it? Children don't feel like they are learning. They don't feel like they are under any compulsion to learn. It's like, so write an A, and usually they have some recitals. And so round the apple down to the leaf is A. You can imagine the number of things the children have developed from there. Up and down is one. So they are reciting. And then they get to zero or circles and they dance around. The circle goes round. The circle goes round. Round and round and round. The circle goes round. If you find your child or your children is, would they really feel like they are? They only feel they are playing. But not knowing that learning is taking place. Now, from our various homes, when sometimes your mother could get you a doll, and usually the boys is the football, and so you are always, you realize that with this play-based learning activities, they are geared towards developing the total abilities of the learner. So the cognitive, the affective, the psychomotor. So with play-based learning, it is important that in the learning environment, we don't make our children feel like they are learning. Just make them feel, allow them to play. And so you are teaching ICT, integrated science, you have some experiments which you would want them, allow them to just fidget them. They will spot certain things at home. But the bottom line is that is why you are a facilitator. And so you guide them so that they don't feel like they are learning, but playing. But within the play, or within each activity they engage in, learning is taking place. So the examples I was giving, up and down is one. So the ability of the learner to start up, down, round the apple, down to, is ah. So
this,
many
this
things.
This is a private school experience. When oh, you but, finish, but when, you finish that, when you finish, I'll give the schools we attended.
Yes, so we are moving in that direction. That is why I started by saying that, you see, in this typical Saito schools that we attend.
No, you didn't. You don't have any experience, Miriam. The experience we have, you are saying up, down.
Uh-huh.
Listen, yesterday, I was telling my students, where we went to, when it's time for break, nobody rings a bell. We sing a song in Chi. Sewo de ekrebiche, duya adake mwa, obomo din ri ara, pon na wefiriko. What is the meaning? If you keep a mouse in a box for a long time, the moment that mouse gets a leeway, it moves. So if you keep us in the classroom from 7 to 10, the moment we get a leeway, we are gone.
Yeah.
It is time for
break. Do you know the reason why? Because when you find yourself in that cage, it's like you are ideally, nobody likes to learn. And so you tell me that I have exams and all of a sudden, hey, I feel I need to sit down, learn, or do something. Nobody. But with the concept that we're talking about now, I mean, children will be free to play. That is the point. But call them to go and learn. Some of them will pretend, pick a book, and then they'll be dozing or doing their own thing. So it's because we're under compulsion. That is why.
So let's take Mavis Beacon as an example.
Mm-hmm.
Mavis Beacon will teach typing in a very nice way. You type in, but unconsciously or consciously, you feel it's an animal trying to swallow something.
Okay.
So you want the animal to swallow, but so you have to type for the animal to move.
Okay.
But before you finish, you may have progressed in terms of your writing skills.
Exactly.
And so I think the point that our students have to understand is that when we say play, it doesn't necessarily mean that we are going to play to make ourselves dirty.
No.
There were so many plays that we engaged in when we were young, and we didn't even know they were important.
Of course.
For instance, how young ladies used to cook. Their mother, as soon as the mother drops the cassava from the fire and starts, they will go gather and pick the dropper, the droplets. They also start learning how to pound. I told my students yesterday that, so some of you, you don't know how to cook because you never engage in those things. We will go gather those things, move to the back where nobody is there. We also try to learn how to pound. Even though you may think we are just playing,
of course,
but unconsciously, we are developing the skill of how to cook. And so as for play-based learning, I've always maintained that without play, this 21st century, nobody takes the world so serious. There is COVID. If you want to take the world serious, go with COVID. If you find yourself at the workplace, it is about social interaction. You cannot, so you find yourself all in a room and every day you are moody because you are serious. Before you realize you have hypertension, you have high blood pressure and other things. If we are not only interested in the development of the cognitive ability of the child, then we have to extend it to the other domains.
Sure.
That is where play comes in. Because we have a play that we call chimpe. Those who are listening to
Those are the wicked ones.
Oh, you call them.
And those chimpe.
You call them wicked. But it develops muscles more than any.
But come on. You see, that it was your. If we should check the BP of those who actually, it would have risen. So it was dangerous.
You think
when
so?
Somebody you have to chimpe something or chin down when by the time you can, the person has finished eating. Come on.
No, but invariably it
so
develops.
So it was affecting the heart.
So it develops the emotions more than anything we taught in the classroom. So if I have engaged in chimpe and I did not die, I come to the university, I get D. The things I have gone through, D is nothing. So if you want to develop the emotions, start with some of this play.
Yes, but you begin from somewhere. Not when I have my last bowl of fufu and then you tell me chin a chimpe and I have to, and then at the end of the
no,
day,
we call it fat ho chin chin down.
Fat ho, you can look at that. Oh, come
so
on.
So you have to place the food there.
That is why I didn't like this idea of eating competition and all that.
But you,
because
Miriam,
it really...
Miriam, it's because you stayed in a self-contained. We grew in compound houses.
No.
We grew up in compound houses. That was the order. Nobody forced you. It's a play.
But children are attracted to play.
If you like the idea, you join. Nobody will force you. It is the most important way of developing our emotions. At the end of the day, you close from school, you come, you are hungry. The moment you pick your food, somebody comes to say, stop the food, move around the house 3 rounds. You are looking at the house like, what the heck? By the end of the day, you wanted to.
And so at that time, you see, we did those things under compulsion. We didn't teach them those values of freely sharing whatever you have with a friend. So you always feel like, unless you practice one or two of these things, you may always be at the receiving end. And so you see,
This is where the characteristics of playful experience will come in. That,
in fact, our parents and great grandparents, they didn't develop, they didn't put up good, playful activities.
They
for
did.
Us.
It was very playful. Your mother will be there. She won't talk. She knows the consequence of some of these things. Because bear with me that as we sit, myself and you, we are very aggressive because probably we grew in compound houses where the order of the day is that you have to...
Survival of the fittest.
Good. Charles Darwin. And so as we journey back, all this that we are saying, our students have to appreciate and understand us that we're going to meet a different kind of students who are very different from us.
Sure.
As for us, we could run over buildings. We could even jump. We could forfeit our foot because where I grew up, you go to play, by the time you come up, you come back, your mother has mashed the cassava. You can't eat it with soup. Neither can you eat it like that. And so the next moment, you find yourself, do I go or I stay? But the children we are going to meet are coming with, because the 21st century itself presents, nobody thought there could be a time where workers, we could ask workers to stay at home for 2 months. We could ask teachers, for example, to stay at home for like 6 months without work, but they will be paid. So 21st century presents a different kind of characteristics that nobody has thought of. And so if you are going back as a teacher and you feel, okay, my students, when I get there, I'll arrange them in a straight line, 2 times 2. So when you say 2, you go and sit down. It is not going to work.
Yeah.
Yes, you have to play with them. And as much as we are saying play with them, it doesn't mean any play is appropriate for your classroom.
Yeah.
So when we talk about play-based learning, it is about how our students will play and make meaning out of the play. So the cognitive has to be developed. This thing that we talked about, put the foot down and run over the wall. By the time you finish, physically you become fit. Even when you are hungry, you can still run. Cognitively, it will teach you it's not every play that is significant. Certain plays are left for certain people. Emotionally, as for the emotions, I won't talk about it. Because as to whether you are angry or not,
nobody cares.
Put your the moment you pick the food, the person says, let's divide it by 2. You may want to give it any meaning you want. It's a play that you wanted. But in the classroom, you can't bring some of this. Okay, so put your foot down and run. Jump. No. Play has to be meaningful. So when we talk about play-based learning, I'm sure we are not just talking about you going to the class and say, a lion has a tail.
No, that one is not part.
It's not part. So which one is
recitals? This one.
So we have to engage in plays that will bring about learning. And when we talk about learning, we are not just talking about the development of the cognitive domain, the affective. So you can have a play like, so you go to class and you say, by the rivers
of what? Babylon.
Africa. Senegal, Gambia, Volta. So you virtually mentioning all the rivers in Africa, but you didn't say, okay, students, let's write the rivers in Africa. Mm-hmm. Yesterday in my class, students mentioned that 30 days of September,
April,
June, and November. That is what they use to calculate their salary.
I do it.
You do? So, these things, we thought we were playing.
Yeah.
We didn't even know the significance. But today, we are feeling that if you're a government worker, you start counting.
Not necessarily to calculate when you receive, just to know the number of days that you have in each month.
Probably.
Yes,
but the whole idea,
not about the salary.
But the whole idea is that these things, it was, we never gave any attention to them.
Yeah.
Our mind was that we've come to school, because I have maintained that Miriam, the child is in class one. Before the child comes to school, the parents have to force the child. So when the child comes and you are like 2 times 2, The next day, the child wouldn't want to come again.
Sure.
So teachers would have to adapt to play-based learning, where students would feel comfortable. So if Saturday, the child still wants to come to the madam, sure. Because when she comes to the madam, the way the madam plays with them, they end up, and you agree with me that play starts from the home.
Sure.
Before it moves to the social environment and probably the classroom.
Yeah. And that was a beautiful one there, a good one. Yeah, so as for play-based learning, 21st century, in fact, our dear listeners and viewers, it is important that as we've been prepared through the course, principles and practice of teaching, when we go to the classroom, we shouldn't make the subject matter look like something, is it a masquerader, something that will scare students. We should present the subject matter, the content, in such a way that children can always play around it. We shouldn't make it feel like it is something that they need extra energy, extra lines of thought, extra what, before they can achieve. Let's just present it in a nice way, in a playful way, irrespective of the level that you are teaching.
And so, Miriam, if we're moving on this tangent, then I feel that our people need to understand this. Even in our homes, to what extent do we play with our children? Sometimes, especially those of us with masculine abilities, we feel our children should call us daddies. They should respect us. And so when our children see us coming from afar, they have to go and hide. Where is the play? So it has implications on the future. That's where our people have to understand. So the moment the child gets to the university and he feels, oh, as for me, now I'm one in a room, the child will do other things that you can't control.
Sure.
So the play we're talking about, students have to learn from play. The play has to start from the home before it moves to the school, so that you can control.
Sure.
Some of our students are footballers. They come to school and we are like, no, mental dictation. The child is there thinking, what is the master saying? Why can't we weave the
content around
football, around music? So if I have to teach concept map, why can't we were just in a moment thinking about by the rivers of Africa, Senegal, Gambia, Bhutan. Why can't we move or weave the lesson around music so that the students will feel, oh, okay, so I can even learn and still do my music,
yeah,
irrespective. But we make it look like, okay, the moment you come to school, by all means, you have to become a professor. Teachers have to be flexible in all this. Teachers have to go down to our level. Somebody asked me, so in the university, how can we play with our students? And I told the person, the only hindrance is that you are too many.
Yes.
But if I have 100 students in my class, I'll weave whatever lesson I'm teaching around what I feel you have to know. Sure. By the time you finish, so when we set questions, they say it's difficult. Difficult because probably it's around concepts woven through play.
Play. Yeah. So I think that we can move on to look at some of the characteristics of play. But if we could announce, I think some.
All right. Good evening once more. This is Radio Windy Bay 98.3. This evening we're here talking about play-based learning in EDC R232, Principles and Practice of Teaching. The point we are trying to make is that the 21st century presents a different era that we've never experienced in the life of human beings. The children we find these days are not like those that we were sitting in classrooms with. And so if you find yourself in classroom, you have to play with your students. When we say play with your students, it doesn't mean you go to certain cultures and they have classes.
playing.
That is not the type of play that we're talking about. We are talking about play that can affect the cognitive, that can affect the affective, and that can affect the psychomotor domain of the child. Most of us have attended, and Miriam, I know you criticize me for this. Those of us who attended the typical Saito schools, we play, we learn. So when we come to the university and you give us D, we don't have a problem. The things we've gone through, there are days you would have to, your friend has seized your slippers on the basis that you were playing and you have been the loser. We are playing Ludo. The loser drinks a cup of water. The cup is not a normal cup, a big one. Even when your belly becomes big, you still have to drink for people to feel that, yes, that is not a type of play. We're talking about a type of play in the classroom. And so I'm going to teach alphabet, consonant, verse, and all that. How do I find a play that can, yes. And so I've always had this example that you want to teach the 10 regions in Ghana and their capitals. There is no need to go and write on the board. Upper West, Upper East, Bogatanga, North, Tamale, this, no. The students, no student is a tabula rasa. It is only when we have this preconceived idea that students are tabula rasas, we go to the class and instead of involving the students, we think, oh, these people, they don't have any knowledge at all, so let me teach. Students come with a normal experience. They are coming from regions. In your classroom, people are coming from Volta. Weave your lessons around play so that even if you want to teach the regions and their capitals, there could be a play for students to come and demonstrate where they come from, the food they eat, the dance they have, the language they speak, and all that.
Yeah, so I believe that our students shouldn't also think that we have a set of books that identifies a number of plays. That is, they need to be creative. So as student teachers, you need to come out with your own concept. Creativity is key. So you have to look at the level that you are teaching, identify certain games or plays that you know you can engage your students with, which at the end of the day will lead to you achieving your objectives. The point is that we shouldn't let the learners feel that they are learning, they need to swallow certain things. The content is something that is so huge and it's waiting for them to complete. Let them just play around the content. And so at the end of the day, they are developing their emotions. And so you realize that they will be self-motivated to even learn or play more around it.
So Miriam, you know, like our children, even Saturday, some of them want to go to school.
Yeah.
What is the reason?
You see, it is because of the new concept, the new dimension of teaching that has come up or that is coming up. Now, teachers, so we're talking about some of these Montessori schools. And some of the teachers, the way they carry or train the children, they would always want to be there. But you find yourself in a home where you don't see your parents because usually they wake up very early for work, and by the time they come home, you are asleep. If you are that type who don't sit down or play with your children, they would always want to go out there because when they go out, they feel they can play with you, and you have loaded them with books. You don't allow them to play. Hey, go and pick your book, as if this world is all about reading.
So in you say, go find a book.
And you see, when they say that to the most interesting thing, you don't even follow. So that is why some of you, I'm sure you were one of those ones that when you were preparing for BEC or WASI and you happen to go and pick your book. In fact, whenever you see that they are pounding fufu, that is where you go and pick the book. And oh, he is steady, so they will not bother you. You see, so we got the tricks that as a child, whenever you pick a book, your parents are okay, they are certain. What you need something, they will just provide you. So you always sit down with the book and your mind is elsewhere. Whilst your parents are in the kitchen or doing their own thing. You feel that, oh, with the book, once you pick a book, you're okay. So some of us, we also behave the same way. You come home and when you realize that there's workload in the house, that is where you pick a book. That is where you want to learn. But all said and done, I think that if our learners at that level, if our teachers made us feel that, in fact, content knowledge is not anything that we should struggle to understand, but in such a way that we always play around
but,
the content.
But Miriam, content is it really important? I have always argued that in this 21st century, when you get to the office and you are too serious, you lose your job in the next moment.
Of course.
Because even the manager is playing.
That is why, you see, yesterday we were here, and I think that the course, our students,
continuity.
Yes. So yesterday we've been looking at curriculum, and I'm sure our students also did that when they were in level 100. Why is it that Tyler didn't emphasize content? He didn't emphasize content in his model of... He said, no. Provide them with the necessary learning experience,
they will learn,
which includes all these and automatic. They will know whatever you want them to know. So I think that Tyler did a brilliant work there. So that is what we are emphasizing now. Provide them with enough experiences, real life play. In fact, any other thing that will engage the learner. We know the learning experiences will engage their mind, their heart, and then their hand.
So that is where I got offended. That you say the games we engaged in. Yes, they were hurtful, but we learned to.
We learned the hard way. That is where my problem is.
The hard
way. It shouldn't be the hard way.
All right. Okay. And so, if you have just joined us, this is Radio Windy Bay 98.3. This evening, we are here discussing principles and practice of teaching. Specifically, we are talking about play-based learning. We have activated the phone lines because what we're talking about is not something that myself and yourself we have to. Just do it on our own. And so our cherished listeners and our viewers on Facebook can phone in with their comments, contributions, and questions. It's 0503-9231-58, 0303-323-2021, 0503-9231-58. It's our WhatsApp and our test line. We are live on Facebook, Radio Windy Bay 98.3. We are live on Twitter, at Windy Bay 983 FM, Instagram Windy Bay 983.
Hello. Good evening.
Good evening. Please, your name and your department.
My name is Naftali CBR.
Hello.
My name is Naftali CBR.
CBR, yes. Okay.
Yes. Please, my question is about the presentation we do in our lecture one.
Okay.
Is that presentation meant to develop our communication skills or is meant for us to learn the content?
Please, can you take it again?
My question is that we do presentation in our various lecture halls.
Yes.
So I want to ask, is this presentation meant for developing communication skills or is meant for us to learn the content?
Okay.
All right. Thank you very much for calling. I think in a due time we will respond to that. But for the meantime, we're still talking about the characteristics. We're now moving on to characteristics. And Miriam, I think the first characteristic is socially interactive.
Yeah.
That whatever play a teacher selects should be socially interactive. As a teacher, you can't go to the classroom. You select an activity and students are doing it by themselves.
Sure.
It should be group-based, everybody involved. It should not favor certain groups of people at the expense of others. So in this era that we are promoting inclusive-based learning, what must our teachers do?
Okay, so yes, inclusive. We should look at those plays, or we should, whenever we are modifying or identifying the kind of plays that we engage our students with, it should be those ones that every learner in the classroom can equally engage in. It shouldn't be one that will be limited to the few ones who have the ability. It should be in such a way that they need to interact with one another. They need to, irrespective of their gender, irrespective of your physical, emotional, or whatever. The place that we engage our children, we engage the learners in, should be those ones that all of them can actively participate. We shouldn't leave any child behind.
And so, especially those of us who feel we have some students in our class whose parents are church members, whose parents are our classmates, and all that. You see, the classroom is not the place for the development of some students at the expense of others. So whenever you select a play, it should not favor only footballers. It should not only favor your classmates. It should not only favor a section of the class. Everybody should feel part
of the play.
Yes. And so it is up to us. We should not select play that those who are visually impaired cannot participate. The play should be socially interactive. In some instances, you go to our classes and we're playing and somebody is seen as an outcast. So the person feels, no, this is not where I belong. We should not create that. The reason is that when we find ourselves in the place of work, those we are going to work with may not come from our church. They may not come from our hometowns, but we still have to work with them.
Yeah, so I believe that in selecting our place or in modifying, designing our place, it should be such that you don't step foot on tribes, on
religion,
tribes,
families, and all that.
So if that is done, I think everybody will get a balanced form of play.
Yeah. The play has to be joyful.
Of course. What is the essence of play?
So I mentioned a play and you said, no, this one, yes, you will learn, but in a hard way.
But while you learning, others are crying. It is not the best. You are happy because you have won. But if it gets to your turn, that is where you also feel hurt. It should be said that you feel you happy from the beginning till the end. It is not the one, it shouldn't be the one that some will be happy whilst others are sad. I think, do we have a caller? No. All right.
And so the main argument you are making is that, yes, and I believe we have to juxtapose this. The classroom is different from the home. The home, sometimes unguided play. Even our parents may not be aware that we are playing. They know we will be sleeping. Before they realize, some of us, we go to play. By the time we come, it's late. They have roamed the whole community looking for us. That is not the play we are talking about. The play has to relate to the child's experience. It has to relate to the child's home. So in the classroom, we have to guide the play. In guiding, we have to ensure that it relates to the child's previous experience. We cannot just go and engage the child in a play that, so for example, they say hockey. In our home, we call it chaskele. You cry. No, Miriam, it's very serious. Chaskele. They place a very small hole there. What you are throwing has to fall in that hole before you come to stand there. Then the person who lost has to go. Before you finish, they cry. Invariably, we are developing your muscles. Because the throwing alone is something else. The point is that whatever play we engage in should be related to our experience. These plays, we never took them serious. This is what the Europeans have developed, and eventually we pay money to participate. I'm a teacher. I'm going to teach in my classroom. I have different type of students. I have maintained that every student has a talent. It's only that we have not found a way to weave that talent into the classroom. As a teacher, bring the child experience into the classroom. So what can you do? In my physical education class, I have badminton. I have those who play for Police Women in Ghana. I have those who play for Narnia FC. As a teacher, my role is to find a pedagogy or a play that will bring all these experiences they have on board. So teachers should not feel that, okay, I'm there to teach for students to pass exam. Yes, the child will pass the exam.
Yeah, hello, caller, your name or your department?
My name is Francis. I'm calling from, I'm a winner.
ICT. Please, Adam. Can you position yourself for, yeah, you are giving us feedback. We're receiving some feedback from you. Yeah, hello. It's okay now.
Yeah, I want to commend our male participants for the contribution. In fact, it was actually related to only the classroom the last time we met. But I think today, extending it to the outside world and what goes on in the house pertaining the plane is actually helping a lot, because we only thought what goes around just in the classroom is what we are talking about. So I would like you to elaborate on what goes on outside the classroom in the house in relation to play-based learning. Thank you very much.
Okay, so if we got you very well, are you there? You want us to see how we can extend these playful activities to the home?
Yes, madam.
Okay, all right.
Yes, madam.
Yeah, we will attend to that. Yeah.
Now, Miriam, I think the whole point has been that some of us as parents, we don't know that when we play with our students or our children, we are teaching.
Yeah.
That's the whole argument. We feel, okay, no, the child is disturbing me. Me that I've returned from work. Please, if you don't do it, somebody else will do it for your child. Eventually, you lose the child in terms of the emotions. So parents have to understand that, yes, okay, she's in school. She has gone to play. I told my student, my child, 1 year, 2 months, she comes back from school. Me, I'm speaking with her and she says, Daddy, again, me, old man like me, again. So I have to virtually repeat what I'm saying. Yeah. It is a way of getting, you see, the students we are teaching have to appreciate the fact that the, from curriculum to edutech to psychology to this, they are all woven together. So Piaget talks about trust versus mistrust. If you play with your child, the child will trust you. If you don't play with the child feels, as for my father, he hates me.
Yeah.
That's it.
Yeah, so if you see, what the caller said, the current one, you see, the point is that the child spends more time at school than the home. Now, some children as early as basic class one, they find themselves in the boarding house. And so it is a school, or you realize that they will spend much time at school than home. The point is that here again, we are being prepared to go and train these children. And so once we engage actively with them in some of these playful activities, when they go home and they meet their classmates, they meet their friends, you realize that because they enjoy the previous lesson in such a way that they were happy, like we talked about, they were socially interactive, they will try and model this when they go home. But if they come to school and it has been serious work, serious face and everything, when they go home, they wouldn't even think about trying to play around a concept that they learned in school. And so this thing can be extended to the house. It's all about how teachers plan and situate it very well, so that when they go home and they meet their colleagues, they would also engage in them. And so apart from playful activities, or we've looked at socially interactive and joyful, again, another characteristic of playful learning is that it needs to be meaningful. The fact that we are hampering or we are emphasizing the use of play in teaching students or learners, we shouldn't forget the fact that it is not everything that is considered as joyful or as socially interactive that we need to promote. Ah, so this kind of activity that I want to engage the students with, is it meaningful at all? How is it going to develop them in terms of their intellectual ability, in terms of their emotional, as well as their physical? And so it is important that we identify, enumerate, and emphasize those playful activities that are meaningful to the learner. If it doesn't make sense, believe you me, the learners will never enjoy it. And so here, it is important that we look at the level of the of our learners. We look out for their developmental level. in terms of their age, their emotional abilities, their physical, their cognitive, etc. So it is important that whatever activity, playful, whatever game, whatever playing session that we engage our students with are those ones that will make meaning to the learner. Other than that, you as a teacher, you in as much as you trying to make sure that your children enjoy the lesson in a playful way, some of them will still be there and will be like, so what at all is this teacher trying to promote? You are trying to make us happy, yet we are not happy. And so the point is that it is important that whatever playful activity we engage the children with, we consider the fact that it needs to be meaningful. The children need to make meaning out of whichever play that we want them to engage in.
And so for the play to be meaningful, I think that then it has to be related to the child's previous experience.
Sure.
And so if you are engaging the child in any play, then, okay, so let's put this in inverted commas. When we say a child, our listeners would probably take it that we are just talking about 6 years, 7 years. No. Even in this university, so that is why I said child in inverted commas. That even in the university, we can use play to teach you. At a senior high school, you can use play. At a basic school. But the point is that how can the child connect? Because if you teach me something in the school, I go back to my family house and I don't find a consistent one, then it means that the play has not been meaningful. So I just wasted my time. So children go to school, they play the whole day. Is it meaningful? What at all are they learning from it? The child has to, the play has to be meaningful in the sense that the child has to feel there is a connection between the play he or she did and his or her previous experience. So, for example, the moment mothers drop their cassava from fire and they start pounding, you see the young ones, in those days, not this 21st century, in the 90s, the young ones will go and gather the leftover. They also move to the backyard and try to emulate what the parents are doing. They are playing, but it is meaningful. It is a way of learning how to cook.
That is all. That is all. Yeah. And so the phone lines are still activated. And you can send us your text messages. We are live on the various social media handles. You can call on 0503-923-1358, 0503-923-1258, and 0332-32-0201. Okay, so we let's look at another characteristic that had to do with actively engaging. Yes, children are going to play. And so it is important that whatever activity they engage, as you can't be dull and be playing at the same time. I can't just think far on that.
So
you need to be actively engaged.
So teachers have to select playful experiences that would prompt the student to be, so you stand up.
Yeah.
More or less. Like you're teaching and the child is sleeping.
And you say you are playing, you've engaged in a playful activity. No. And so with this, a lion has a tail, you realize that they try to be on their feet, touch the video, it has a tail, it has a big head, and then so that at the end of the day, you are developing their cognitive, their affective, their psychomotor.
So my head, my shoulder, my knees, unfortunately, my voices.
Okay. So now they
you have a good voice. Maybe you can give us a theme.
Okay, so I think in your Saito, in our Saito,
you didn't attend
that
Saito.
Is where it's my head, my shoulders.
No, Miriam, Achimota is not Achimota is not Saito.
The point is that head, shoulders, knees and toes, knees and toes. Head, shoulders, knees and toes,
knees and toes.
And eyes and mouth and nose.
Achimota
and
one. Ears. So let me give you the one from Presby.
Knees and toes.
Let me give you the one from Presby.
Okay.
My head, my shoulder, my knees, my toes. As you are singing, there is one boy sleeping at the back. He wake up, he don't know where he is. We are laughing because today we are talking about play-based learning.
Yeah, you need to be happy.
Hey, you can't go to... So you graduate and you have BP. Teaching has to be playful.
Of course.
We have to play. We shouldn't assume that we are the master of all knowledge. And for that matter, we are too serious. So as students are sleeping, we have given homework. They have brought it. The homework, they didn't even do it. It's their mothers who did it. The mothers are those who suffer. So, as for the fathers,
hello, Kala, your name and your department.
Please, Grace. I'm going to speak from Ajumako level 200.
Great, Grace.
I'm so grateful. Thank you so much. Please, I just want to know, sir, is there a difference between play and game? Because I see you people using it in the kingdom. I just want to clarify. Thank you.
Okay, so it will be addressed. Any difference between play and games? Okay.
Yes, please. Okay.
Yes, and so we were just trying to make the point that as for our classrooms has to be fun. So that even when students don't feel comfortable, but making fun doesn't necessarily mean that, okay, they are just there.
Sure.
They have to learn something before they leave. Yeah. Would you want to clarify the question before?
I think we have two.
Okay.
So the first one, let's have the first one was about the presentations that lecturers have been engaging students with. Is it meant to develop their cognitive or is just...
It's a skill. The other part. Today I was speaking with a lecturer. I wouldn't want to mention the name.
Sure.
In a PM, about PMP. And he said that his students had to go take... integrated pedagogies, they went so field trip. Some of them had to trip the whole campus, take pictures, choose some of their people as group leaders, others as photographers. And the way they presented it, I was wowed. So I just told him that, say, as for this one, whoever did it, the person needs commendation. It's a presentation, but the way the person has presented it, it's not just developing the cognitive, the affective, the psychomotor are all developed. So when we say come and present your work, we are not saying go and chew the information and come and stand there and say a matter is anything that has weight and can occupy space. People will present the same matter in other formats that may look more appealing. Everybody looks at it and it's like, wow. Cognitively, they are wild. Affectively, they are wild. Psychomotor-wise, they are wild. I don't know if you want to add something.
Yeah, that is it. And so, yeah, it's a skill. At this level, so I think as students, then if they were thinking that presentations were meant for them to just play, the fact that they shouldn't be serious about it, then I'm sure that...
So one person will do the work. The rest are supporters.
Sometimes you even struggle to find your group members to append their signatures. And that becomes a problem. Yeah, so with presentations, yeah, at our level, we shouldn't take things for granted. It is important that we are trying to develop these skills in you. Away from the university, you're going to subject yourself to scrutiny under so many circumstances, and you need to... know how to stand in front of people to talk and then all that. So the issue of play and then game, you see, games are also recreational activities, and what every recreational activity at the end of the day, it is meant that it develops the total abilities of the learner. So your cognitive, your affective, and then the psychomotor. And so a game, in trying to incorporate a play in a lesson, you could modify, have some games. They are like, the mother umbrella is a play. So the play can take any form. You could choose a game in trying to present a lesson in a playful way. So they are not so different. It is all about actively engaging the learners. And of course, with these games, we have a set of rules that govern them. And so you were giving examples like... chin chin down, what happens before you roam, put your foot down, roam about and all that. We have set of rules that guide them. But with the play, that is where we have the free ones, the guided and unguided, where students feel that they can do anything at all in a happy or joyous way.
All right, so I think we will take the last of the characteristics of the play-based learning, and then we would conclude. But if you are still with us, I think the lines are still active. You can phone in with your comments, questions, and contributions, and then we will take it from there. And so, Miriam, what is the last characteristic of?
So we've looked at socially interactive, iterative. We are yet to look at the iterative.
Iterative. We talked about this, joyful, but we didn't mention it.
Yeah, joyful, meaningful, actively engaging. So, okay.
No, we just talked about all of them. But the point we are trying to make to our listeners is that in our homes, yes, the child plays before coming to the school. But sometimes the child engages in a play that the child doesn't connect it to any experience. Yes. So the child picks a pomit because he or she has seen the mother using the pomit. And so he or she smears the whole pomit around the body. It's a play. The child is playing. But how does it connect to the child's future?
That is it.
So anytime we try to engage the child in a certain play, we should look at how it is going to affect the child physically, emotionally, and in terms of the physical development. Sure. Because we have played before. Miriam, the experience we have, if we are to sit here and talk about them, this car tie, we pick them without the rim. We put two sticks in between them. Then we put water. When we put water, it doesn't make noise. So you have to put sand in them. So as we are rolling, it is making chon, 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 and we are happy. We are still playing, but how does it connect to our future? So in as much as we are saying that play should connect with the social realities, so how would I use this play to live outside school? How would I use this play to in future, if I find myself, I've told my students that if you marry and you are still sterile, it will collapse. If you find a job and you are still that hard person, me, I don't play, go away, go away. Even your children will not feel comfortable coming around you. So as for play, we need it. But one thing we should be careful is not play, all plays are meaningful.
Yeah.
Not all plays are meant for a certain level of people. So in choosing a play, how socially significant would that play be? How joyous would that play be? We are playing and it's like punishment. So put your phone down or put your foot down and go around this building 3 times.
And interestingly, not to cut you, in those days in the typical Saito schools where when there's a free time, instead of monitoring the learners in the environment to play, we ask them to put their head down. Hey, put your head on the table. You'll be forced to. But at that time, that is where we could monitor and see our students develop, see the learners or children develop in skills here and there.
So you remember in 2015, a student shot another student because this child has been playing Bushia Bushia, so with a gun. The child went and the father's gun was there, picked the gun and felt, okay, I'm going to shoot. Before he realized,
There was bullet in it.
And so as for play, yes, we have to play. But the play has to be meaningful. It has to be joyous. It has to relate to the child's experience. So we're talking about iterative and all that.
Yeah. And so with this one that you just said, we need to monitor the learners in the learning environment. Some of the things or the objects they may be using in their play may not be encouraging. Using of pointed stones, objects, sharp objects here and there, we shouldn't allow them. The fact that we say they should play doesn't mean that we are the market where anything can be done. Anybody at all can raise their voice and then advertise what he or she is selling. No, we need to do it in a systematic order so that it will make meaning to the child.
All right, so listeners, if you just joined us, this evening we're doing radio lectures on EDCR 232, Principles and Practice of Teaching, and specifically we are talking about play-based learning and specifically the characteristics of play. We are very thankful for having you around us this evening. We thank you very much. We want to thank our dear and our cherished technicians for being with us throughout the time. God willing, next week we will continue with the next segment of the radio lecture. And we pray that you join us. Please, COVID is still real. Join us and make sure you mask up and you adhere to all the protocols as has been indicated to us. Thank you very much. My name has been Stephen Kwachiape from the Department of Educational Foundations, and I'm here with my colleague,
Miss Miriam Oga from the same department.
Thank you.